Hi, this is Dr. Damon Miller, your Organic MD.
And this is Carlisle Koash. Welcome to the OrganicMD.com videocast. This is part two in our series on retinitis pigmentosa.
We're just talking about some individual diseases. We work with all of the degenerative eye diseases, the retinopathies, the maculopathies. We're doing this on retinitis pigmentosa, and today we're going to be talking about some of the research that's going on for retinitis pigmentosa. And I could make this talk really short. I said something similar. We did a similar talk about Stargardt disease. But there's really not a whole lot of interesting research going on for RP right now. I know that's going to offend some of the researchers. But the research that's going on about RP is just, in my opinion, playing around the edges. I get calls from people that I work with, and they're really excited. They read an article in the newspaper that says, oh, they're doing a big study at Duke on fish oil and DHA. And I'm going, I want to scream because, you know, there is peer-reviewed medical literature showing the value of fish oil in these diseases back from the 60s and the 70s. And the only thing that's different is that the research that was done 30, 40, 50 years ago wasn't done by ophthalmologists. And so they don't read it. They could find it in Medline. They could read about it. So, you know, they're researching lutein, they're researching antioxidant vitamins, they're researching fish oil and things like that. But you have to understand medical research, doctors, as much as any other human being, are shaped by their expectations. And ophthalmologists hold the expectation that these problems are not reversible without some kind of major intervention. They just haven't figured out what that intervention is yet, but they're looking for it. And so there is, and there's another thing just in terms of the medical model of how research is done. The money that's out there to fund research comes from two major places when you're talking about eye disease. There's some very respectable nonprofit groups that have raised hundreds of millions of dollars for research. Unfortunately, that hasn't yielded anything. There's no treatment that's come out of all of those hundreds of millions of dollars of research. And then there's research that's done by drug companies, pharmaceutical companies, medical device companies looking for some kind of a procedure, a device, a drug that could be sold to you. And that skews the research because they're looking for something that they can do to you. And what we found and what we'll talk about in our next and third installment of this series of podcasts, video podcasts, is we'll be talking about the things that we have found that actually can reverse these diseases and lead to regeneration in the eye, actual regeneration. Your eye fixes itself if we give it the kind of support that it needs.
Which, you know, that's a little bit harder maybe to for these larger companies. I mean, one understands that if you're going to put and spend a lot of money to research something, the hope is that there's some sort of outcome that you can sell and regain some of the money that you spent on all that research. I mean,
right.
We understand that model and that approach, but these are the kind of things where people, yes, they might spend some money to get supplements or to get some components, but so much of it is done themselves that that's harder to track.
Well, right, basically. And there's no, you know, the medical model, how things get dealt with in this day and age, it doesn't include some procedure that's going to take hours of hand-holding and instruction and training and teaching of how you take care of the health of your eyes. And then staying with you for the months and years it may take for your eyes to actually regenerate themselves. You know, the good news is that there are things you can do that will actually help you get your vision back. The bad news is that you have to do it. It works, but only if you do it. And you have to do it with some consistency for many months, even years, to really go all the way. And, you know, that's just not the way that ophthalmologists practice. That's not the way most doctors practice. That's not the medical model. And, you know, you're saying it's hard for a company. It's what's really hard. You know, I was talking about expectations from the doctors. Your doctor, your eye doctor, doesn't believe that there's anything that can be done. And they hammer that message home to you relentlessly. Every time you go see them, they're so sorry that there's nothing they can do for you. There's no drug. There's no surgery. This is a hopeless case. This is a hopeless disease. It's irreversible, blah, 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 blah. And, you know, you hear that often enough, you come to believe it. You actually think there's nothing that can be done. And so I'm just kind of setting the stage here for our third talk that's coming up where we're going to talk about some of the things you can do. But please don't be holding your breath waiting for someone to find the magic bullet for this, because believe me, it's not going to come in your lifetime. it's been 10 years away for the last 30 years, and it's going to be 10 years away 10 years from now. You know, it's a promise right now. And, you know, I do hope that something comes of all this work that's been done. But, you know, there is something that exists right now. Get started with that and keep your ear open, your ears open as to what's coming down the pike. But don't be holding your breath. Get started with what you can do now. It will pay off, and you'll be glad you did.
You know, what strikes me is that a number of the things, treatments that we do for these illnesses and for the other eye diseases, enough of the components are really, they do take time. They require a change and a shift in one's understanding and perspective. A number of these things are also looking at emotions and stress and that kind of thing. And, you know, in my experience doing counseling and especially doing spiritual counseling, that these things, if you look and you talk to people, and there has been some research done on the efficacy of, say, spiritual counseling for people.
Right.
But it's not like I had one session, I took one thing and it went away. You know, it's usually over a period of time, through a series of kind of working more deeply with a situation, with a problem, looking at these things. And so it's harder to sort of say, you know, take three spiritual pills and you'll be better. And it has a much different process. It still is potent, but I think maybe perhaps also in our culture we've also become acculturated into what can I get now? What can be done immediately? How can it be changed immediately? How can I have it shift right now?
Yeah. I mean, everybody wants it now, but you know, the good news here is that if you stay with us and you try out the things that we show you, it doesn't just affect your eyes. Mm-hmm. Your health gets better.
Yep.
Your life gets better. You're happier. You're less stressed. There are just a lot of things that get better if you take care of your health, not just your eyes. And, you know, Carlisle and I just published a book called Stem Cells Heal Your Eyes. You can get a copy of that on Amazon.com. There's Kindle and paperback, large print paperback versions. I really encourage you to go and get that book and read it, because it has a whole lot more about what we're talking about here, and it'll answer the questions you have. But I'll see you the next time. We're going to be talking about what we know about the treatment of this problem we call retinitis pigmentosa.
So thank you all for joining us for this part two of this three-part series. Just keep listening in. There's always great content on the YouTube channel and, of course, on organicmd.com.
Yeah, so like the videos, subscribe, keep in touch.
And we'll talk to you soon.
Thank you.